to me. Oh, oh,
I live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. This is the Empowerment Hour. More progressive-minded people, thinking independent of the mainstream and consensus mindset, listen every day. And I want to thank the thousands who came on yesterday. Why yesterday, I don't know. But thousands of additional listeners came in on yesterday's program to listen in. So hopefully they're passing the word. I stopped doing interviews of any kind in the year 2000. I had done thousands of interviews, and I just believed that it was enough. And more often than not, the interview became about me instead of the topic I was interested in discussing. And I didn't like being a part of that celebrity culture, so I dropped out of it. And I believe that if you have something of value to share, people will pay attention and share it with others. So today, for the 100 million downloads of the show, if you look on Google, Google the War on Health, 1.8 billion, that's with a B, billion search results as of this morning. So it's not as if we become obscured. You, me, people who are in the progressive movement seeking to address social change and political corruption and negative malfeasance by special interest groups and promote healing and health of the world, we're growing under their radar. Today, we'll take you on that journey. We're going to hear about the challenges that we face, and I'll bring in some interesting concepts when I play a clip. I didn't have a chance yesterday, but today I will be having a guest in the second part of our program, and I wanted you to hear about the real strength and weaknesses of the Green New Deal and how the Democrats have become the new war party, the new terrorist party, the new fascistic party. It's hard to imagine, but my God, today they're similar to the Democrats that created the Ku Klux Klan. They're just filled with rage, and they're flailing away to maintain their power, and they don't know how to communicate with young people. The old guard is entrenched. So not only on today's show am I having Ejimu Baraka, and he has been a political and grassroots activist and defender of human rights, both at home and abroad, for 40 years. He was Jill Stein's vice presidential running mate for the Green Party during the 2016 election and was the founding executive director of the Human Rights Network, the first American organization committed to applying international human rights standards in the United States. He'll be my guest. And we're going to talk about how what they, the Green Party, and its members created, the Democrats have usurped it. And why didn't they give credit to these people? Why didn't they invite him and others in the Green Party who have real integrity in to discuss this and to show its strengths? Anyhow, we're going to do that today. And then also tonight at the Progressive Commentary Hour, we're going to have a really very interesting discussion. We're going to talk about the new tyrannies, fascism, and suppression of free thought and free speech and identity politics for the full hour with Danny Sheehan. This will be an interesting discussion. Yeah, you won't want to miss that. That's coming at you tonight. But we also today will take your calls. I've told Jesse in New York, play some of your questions so we can start getting them on the air. And if you want to get your question on the air, here's the number you call, and you can record a message, 862-800-6805, 862-800-6805. And we'll get to as many as I can today before my guest. But we always start with the latest on health and healing, because all of us deserve to live a longer, healthier life. And now, from Chalmers University, which is in Sweden, researchers have found another natural source of helping the body with a natural antibiotic. and it's the fungi. And they called it the potential goldmine for the production of new antibiotics. And there are strains of the bacteria building up a resistance to modern antibiotics. Their findings have come just at the right time because people have eaten so many antibiotics in their chicken and their beef. And why do you think that they put antibiotics in chicken and beef and pork and fish? Because the conditions of factory farming, A, are so unsanitary, but also a professor in California found that if you give antibiotics, which destroy the immune system, to cattle, it allows them to gain weight faster. And since cattle are sold based upon their weight, getting them heavier with antibiotics, even though those antibiotics are going to be passed on to you when you eat the meat, it's not a good thing. And then you have these traces of antibiotics. And then when you have something that requires an antibiotic, it doesn't work. Hence, antibiotic resistance. So they found that there's 24 kinds of fungi that have natural antibiotic qualities. And they discovered 1,300 pathways that more than anything showcase fungi as viable suppliers of natural bioactive chemicals into the body. Remember, your mushrooms are also a part of that. So when you eat shiitake mushrooms, when you eat almost any kind of mushroom, your body is responding, building up its natural immune response, including anti-cancer. So take your probiotics. That's great for you. And have things like bee propolis. That's top of my list for natural antibiotics. Bee propolis, shiitake mushrooms, also white cap mushrooms. Just your regular white cap mushrooms are terrifically good for your immune system. Now, a separate study from Stanford University School of Medicine shows that honeybee protein can help keep stem cells youthful. That's important. Why? Because according to researchers from the Stanford University School of Medicine, an active protein component of royal jelly helps honeybees create new queens. A similar protein has been identified in mammals, which keeps cultured embryonic stem cells pluripotent. And this was published in Nature Communications. Now, the protein causes cells to remain pluripotent, meaning they can become any cell within the body under conditions which normally trigger them to develop into specialized cells. And this finding will likely fan flames to debate the issue of the regenerative powers of royal jelly, but more importantly, reveals new pathways to pluripotency and suggests novel ways to keep your stem cells in a state of suspended animation until further needed. And folklore reveres royal jelly as a form of super medicine in Europe and Asia, and DNA sequencing of what is called roalactin, that's R-O-Y-A-L-A-C-T-I-N, which is the active component in the royal jelly, is unique to honeybees. A structurally similar mammalian protein has been identified that can maintain stem cell pluripotency. And this discovery was found along the way in a process of wondering how a royal jelly diet could trigger extreme differences between the queens and worker bees. And this is what they did with an MD, PhD, and colleagues looking at royal jelly. Now, isn't it interesting? Why is it interesting? Because when I first came to the city, New York City, there was a little tiny health food store up on, I think it was 101st and Broadway. I think the gentleman's name was Vic Boff. And there was a person working in there who always had this white lab coat on. And he was a pharmacist. And every day when I would stop off there and he'd make me a fresh glass of there was only two things you could get back then, apple and carrot. Later, he added some celery, I think 3 years before he added the celery, because it was hard to get any organic produce at that point. And he would always ask me, did I want some royal jelly? And I grew up with beehives. I've had beehives my whole life. And those of you who used to come up the Fertiller Farm upstate, you saw all those beehives. We'd do a class on, you know, the royal jelly and how you extract the honey so you don't adulterate it and you don't have to use heat. In any case, he would take this royal jelly and he would give me a spoonful every day. I felt great. Well, now he wasn't alone. People who involved in the natural hygiene movement have been using royal jelly for decades. Why? Because Dr. Kellogg was an advocate of royal jelly. Then Bernard McFadden, who followed him, was an advocate of royal jelly. And then others who came after that, like Gaylord Houser and Gloria Swanson and others, would start using royal jelly. Anyhow, I'm a big advocate. I take a teaspoon of royal jelly every day. You get the raw, organic royal jelly. But now they're finding there's an ingredient in there that protects stem cells and keeps them youthful. Hence, the idea that they didn't have any scientific proof, but they had empirical proof that by taking royal jelly, it would help your longevity. They were right. Now, when I make my protein shake in the morning, I always add in a teaspoon of sesame seed paste. It's called tahini. It's raw. It's organic. And I know about tahini, and I know about the seeds, and I'm always interested in good science. Well, this is a study from Shahid Bihashi University Medical Sciences, and it says the following. It says that compelling research, quote, concludes sesame seed paste, that's tahini, can reduce the risk of cardiovascular disease by almost 40% in only 6 weeks. Whoa. Now, put that in context. Heart disease might sound like it's particularly inevitable, with almost 17 million people dying of it worldwide each year. A number of that is projected to exceed 23 million in the near future. However, you actually have far more control over it than you think. Now, I'm traveling all over, and one of the stops in filming was out in California, Northern California, near Napa Valley, where Dr. Dean Ornish, one of America's, well, in fact, I would say the first holistic cardiologist, he was able to reverse heart disease with just diet, exercise, and stress management, and he just prevented 9 people who otherwise would have had their hearts removed in a heart transplant. Not one of them had to have a heart transplant because of his work. And he published it in twice, once in The Lancet, once in New England Journal of Medicine. He proved by the gold standard that you can reverse heart disease, blockage of the arteries, carotid artery, main arteries. You can repair damaged epithelial, the lining of the arteries and veins. He proved this. It did not then follow that medicine says, yeah, show us a better way, a gold standard, and we will follow you. Nobody followed him. Only individual doctors and only a handful of those, like Dr. Neil Barnard did, for example. And only, I'm going to suggest, maybe a couple hundred out of 900,000. But he was right, and they were wrong. They're still using statins, which are garbage. In any case, he was a big believer in the seeds. Well, sesame seed, eaten as a seed, don't get digested very well. Probably 90%, I'm guessing, passes out of the body because it's very tough, extremely tough seed. But if you take the paste, which is the tahini paste, and if you get it raw and organic, then you have something that's going to help your heart. Now, if one single item can prevent or reverse up to 40% of cardiovascular disease in 6 weeks, imagine if you add in coconut oil and flaxseed oil and the omega-3 fatty acids and magnesium citrate and coenzyme Q10, ubiquinol, and potassium and L-carnitine and cayenne and taurine and hawthorn and anjou. Well, then there's no reason you should have any heart problems at all. So I just want to share that with you because that I thought that was really good, that sesame seed paste, tahini, has a very powerful preventative measure. And this was published in the Archives of Iranian Medicine, and it found that tahini can actually reduce cardiovascular risk factors among type 2 diabetics is an important finding when you consider that diabetics have a far higher risk of cardiac death on account of the unhealthy blood lipid ratios and the qualities that are caused by chronically high blood sugar levels and insulin resistance. So that's important. So save a life. Get your tahini each day. Now also, another study that I read this morning from Hamadan University Medical School and published in Clinical and Translational Medicine shows the omega-3 fatty acids. Again, you can get them from fish, but you can also get them from walnuts and avocados, associated with fewer and shorter seizures in epileptics. Now, I have a whole protocol for stopping epileptic seizures. Unfortunately, whatever I do is only heard by people who are following my work. And even though I publish in peer-reviewed literature and have for my entire career, it doesn't get the attention. Once again, you can have quality information that is proven by every gold standard. It doesn't mean that everyone's going to stop what they're doing and change. But for you to know that you can actually stop seizures, have fewer seizures, shorter seizures, by having 1,500 milligrams a day of the omega-3 fatty acids. And this was a triple-blind trial just out this week. So I wanted to share that with you. And they didn't even have a lot of the omega-3. I would have doubled the amount they used. They used 120 milligrams of DHA for 16 weeks. I would have gone 400 milligrams and even got a higher rate. And also, finally, from Queen Mary University in the United Kingdom, a new test is 100% effective at detecting cervical cancer. A new test has been shown to be 100% effective at detecting cervical cancer in a trial of over 15,000 participants that was developed by researchers at Queen Mary University in London and published in the International Journal of Cancer. And the new epigenetics-based test was demonstrated to outperform the Pap smear and human papilloma virus test, as well as being more cost-effective, predicting development of cervical cancer up to 5 years in advance compared to HPV and Pap smear testing. So, you've got something brand new medically and published in a major peer-reviewed journal and from a major university, and it's better than a Pap smear. How about that? So, make yourself aware of that. And it was developed by a doctor, Attila, A-T-T-I-L-A, and the last name is Lorinz, L-O-R-I-N-C-Z. And so, good for them. I commend them on that. We are almost 20 minutes into our program. We're going to take a break and come back, and we're going to go to your calls. Please stay with us.
Just move on up toward your destination. Though you may find.
Congratulations, Gary. This innovation of allowing you to get calls directly from people after they've been stimulated by listening to your show, it is a really good idea, you know. And it's a real pleasure to listen to the fine mind you've developed give answers to people's questions. Now, by the way, my name is Stephen Anderson. I'm from Long Island. And my concern is when I talk to people about going to a vegan diet, the place the conversation breaks down is their uncertainty about how exactly do you get your protein if you don't eat meat. And, you know, you've addressed this a little bit, but I just think if you would just speak to the average person with an ordinary kitchen, you know, how do they go to the store and buy what's needed in order to be able to get the protein that the body needs so that they can be safe in knowing they're getting that protein when they stop eating meat altogether. I really think it's the logjam that's stopping a lot of people. So I don't know how you would see this. But again, I thank you for having this line. Congratulations and keep up the good work.
Okay, well, it's a legitimate question, and I'm sure one that many people in this audience have tried to reconcile. People say they would become maybe interested in doing vegetarianism or even more radically so a vegan diet if they didn't end up wasting away and becoming anemic and sickly. This myth that we need a lot of protein in the diet three times a day has conditioned people to believe this. So your issues are legitimate. I'll address them as such. And this is an area that I have some unique specialization. And I'm going to reverse engineer your question and its answer. I was curious when I was in dietetic school, studying to become a registered dietitian, which I am, how is it that people living in cultures around the world that we know about and have identified are eating primarily rice and beans, or cassava and beans, or millet and something else. And only on rare occasion do they have any meat, like a celebration or a wedding. But day to day, they're healthy and they're long live. And I was using an example of down in Brazil, there was people able to climb trees. I watched it. I was there. And a guy shimmied up this tree. He did not have a support belt on. He was barefoot. Went clear up there and cut down some coconuts. And I'm looking at this thing, wow. And I'm in my 20s, and I said, how old are you, sir? And he was 64 years old. How did he do that? Oh, his diet. But his diet didn't have the meat in it. It had lots of fruits, and it had breadfruit, had gourds and squash, and something that looked like a potato but wasn't. And they're happy. So I knew that we were missing something. And when I raised the issue in class, the audience says, read your textbook. That's the final word. And I was reading Normal and Therapeutic Nutrition by Robinson, a very good book. But in this one section on protein, it was my belief that the author was not aware of something. Because it was stated that you must have protein three times a day, breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and it can only come as a complete protein if it's an animal protein, meaning you can have dairy, that's complete protein, meaning it contains all eight essential amino acids, a ninth amino acid, methionine, if you're pregnant. And if you had beef, chicken, fish, veal, pork, all that is a complete protein, and hence growing up, in my home, and I'm sure many other homes, primarily our mothers made sure that we ate right. We had to have a big breakfast to start the day, and generally that was eggs and bacon, or eggs and, depending upon where you lived in the country, if it's in the South, you had the worst god-awful food ever created, grits. I can't stand grits. People love grits. Good for them. I can't stand it. It tastes like something fell on the floor, and 2 days later someone came back and said, what's this? Well, that's grits. Let's eat it. Yeah, fine. And or you had hash browns. Now, those I like because they would chop up red peppers and onions, and that was okay. But then came the pork. Now, here's the strangeness. You had Canadian bacon. Ooh, what's that? Well, it's just part of a pig. And then you had bacon. But they're both from the same animal. Why is one revered? And then you had pork patties, and that was just ground up like a ground beef. And you would have toast, generally burnt, with butter on it. And you would have a glass of milk. Or in my case, that's what my brothers ate, and that's why they ended up a little simple, I think. So anyhow, I would have, they'll get even with me, I can hear them now. Steve, your brother called you simple for eating crap in the morning. So I would have oatmeal, still cut oatmeal, And in it, Mom would put the cream, because we got a milkman who came each day, and he would deliver the cream, a bottle of milk, and it was not pasteurized. It was not homogenized. It was pasteurized. And she would pour that real sweet cream in it, and then she put cinnamon in it, and then on top of that, she put some nuts in there. And then I would have that with milk. Later, I found out I was allergic to milk, and once I gave up milk and went strictly vegan, boy, there was a big difference in how much energy I had. In any case, everyone was propagandized over and over again, and this is the way you should eat. And you should eat a big steak. And people prided themselves on being good caregivers if they could actually get a 2-inch thick steak. And people would talk about, yeah, we had 2-inch steaks last night. Like, why not a 1-inch? Well, 2 inches. Yes, 2 inches, you're strong, working-class, middle-class person. Anyhow. And Dad used to like to leave the fat on, because fat is what imparts taste to food. And he would eat that, and then he would go in and lay down on the couch and start snoring, and little dingy-wingies of mucus be dribbling down someplace. It was a gross scene, and there was a permanent indentation in the couch. And I could sit in the couch because there was... it was a true story. Oh, God, my family were so gross. The kind of people would step out of their underwear and just walk away from it, like somehow someone's supposed to come out of a closet, pick up their underwear, take it to the laundry, clean it, and put it back in their room. Wow, somewhere along the way they lost hygiene 101. And I was this one, and they made fun of me because I was the hygienic one, and my younger brother intentionally would drink right out of the carton of milk and then look at me while I was doing it. Like, okay, now, Gary, we know you're not going to have this, and he'd stick his finger in the peanut butter, stick his finger in the mustard, knowing I would not eat it. And then, so I was always one getting the back end of that, and that's fine. That's what family are served for, make you laugh at yourself and your own idiosyncratic behavior. But that's how everyone ate. Everyone ate where I came from until television dinners came, and then everybody got on that kick, getting that little stupid little metal, that little stand, metal stand, and then you got the aluminum foil, toxic, you pop it in and you cook the food, and then you eat this food that tastes like crap. But everyone did it because, oh, you don't have to be in the kitchen now. But once a year, I think it was one day once a year, one of our friends would pick blackberries and would actually get to taste a real fruit once a year. It's not something out of a jar or can that immediately would send you into a diabetic coma. There was so damn much sugar and everything. So I saw how we all grew up, and I knew it was wrong. Deadly wrong. And so when I was in dietetic school, I knew that we were eating wrong, and people around the world were eating better and living longer. And then my final thought on this was, I don't care what anyone else thinks. I'm going to be a vegan. They don't like it. They don't have to be. And so I started doing an experiment. Now, this is what's important. This is the takeaway message. In the experiment I did, which was finally published in a peer-reviewed journal, I wanted to see what exactly are in beans and grains that make them so healthy as far as the protein. I didn't know how much protein was in there, but I was a scientist, a research fellow at the Institute of Applied Biology and Anti-Aging Medicine, so I did this work, and I thought I made a mistake. So I asked Dr. Berman, could you take over and redo it? I made a mistake here. So I came back the next day, and he said, no mistake. And I said, but it has to be a mistake. Because this showed that beans, I started with just beans, black beans, has as much protein of all 8 essential amino acids as meat. And I thought, well, that can't be, because every textbook, including the textbook I study from, every nutritionist everywhere, everyone who studies nutrition, their textbooks all said the same thing. Only animal proteins are complete. And 2 to 3 weeks later, redoing this every single day, I realized, no, they were all wrong. All of science was wrong. All of medical science was wrong. all of dietetic science was wrong when it came to how to feed people. They were all dead wrong. Now, that gives you a strange position to be in, and I didn't quite know what to do with it, so I went to the director of the institute, and I said, I think I've stumbled upon something that's very important, but I also think that it'll be immediately rejected because you're dealing with a $200 billion a year meat, dairy, egg, chicken, fish industry. No one is going to give up a penny of their sales and jobs if you say we don't need any of this. But I'm saying now, and I said this at a meeting of all 16 department heads, I said, I'm telling all of us right now, I have absolute, irrefutable, total scientific proof, replicated multiple times, that we do not need to eat anything with a heartbeat or a face or that has a mother. We need no animal proteins whatsoever to be healthy, vitally healthy. In fact, to the contrary, the less we eat of bad foods, the healthier we're going to be, the longer we're going to live. And they just kind of looked at me like I had two heads, and it was of no difference. So that's where this began. And it took me 12 years before I could get that article published in the peer-reviewed journal. I sent this out to every scientific journal, the American Dietetic Association, the National Institutes of Health, the Harvard Health Program, the MIT Health Program. Everywhere I sent this, no one acknowledged it. And yet this was revolutionary science. So I realized then that we were not going to give up meat or dairy because we were conditioned to believe it was what we needed. So you're dealing with a conditioning issue. And it's easier to digest food that is not animal protein. You're going to live a longer life if it's a plant-based diet, a healthy plant-based diet, about 9 years. You're going to be trimmer. You're going to be less overweight. You're less likely to have diabetes. Because where do you get your protein? You get them from the legumes, the beans, of which there are over 200 variety. You get them from the whole grains, unprocessed grains like brown rice and steel-cut oats and millet and quinoa. You get them from the seeds, sunflower seeds, pumpkin seeds, sesame seeds, chia seeds, flax seeds, hemp seeds. So you get all the protein you need. Like a can of beans, soybeans gives you about 26 to 29 grams of protein. That's over half a day's supply in one single can. In red beans, which I just had last night, it's 7 grams of protein. Now, when you think of how much protein we need a lot less protein than what we're actually consuming. We are protein manic. We're like cockroaches on speed when it comes to our diet. We're just nuts. We start fads, we eat crap, and we eat a lot of it. What we don't eat is healthy. What is not a fad is health. It's like we have a race to the grave with a fork and a spoon. So, how much protein do we actually need? Well, I'll give you an example. I'll use myself as an example. I'm nearly 6'2". Ideal weight is 185, but it varies depending upon my racing, what I'm training for. I have 2.4% body fat, and for me, that's excellent. For other people, they would need more. I have about 25 grams of protein in a simple vegetable protein powder in the morning in my shake. I'll have another shake later in the day. So I've got 75% of my protein requirements covered in just two drinks. At my one meal a day, I'll have probably another 15 grams protein. So I've got all I need. I'm up to the high end of what I need, about 70 grams protein. Now, pregnancy and fever, and there are conditions that will cause you to have a little more, but not a lot more. Now, let's just do the math, and I want to show you how complicit in being wrong in science people are, especially dietitians. And by the way, when was the last time you saw a healthy dietitian? In fact, that should make the news. The New York Times just showed that for the first time in American history, we actually have a healthy dietitian. You know, the very people who are supposed to get you healthy when you're sick in a hospital, good luck with that. 50,000 died of malnutrition in 1 year from dietetics, foods. In any case, let's just say that you have a pound. And a pound is how many ounces? Well, it's 16. Let's say half of that steak is protein. So you got 8. Now, you got 8 ounces. How many grams to an ounce? 28.35. Let's just round it off and say you've got 8 ounces times 24 grams. That gives you 192 grams of protein in one item. But you only need between 40 to 70 in a day. So with one item in one meal, you've just eaten 3 days worth of protein. Now, that's going to create toxic reactions to your liver, your kidney, and there's no way to store protein. So all this is going to be stored as fat and break down in urea and ammonia and create toxic oxidative stress and constipation. And if you wonder why people today go in and they can spend too much time on the toilet and strain and end up with hemorrhoids, it's because the peristalsis has been adversely affected by over-congestion in the intestine. People have upwards of 13 pounds of impacted feces in their intestine, and that's fermenting, and that's at 97 degrees, and it's wet and filled with bacteria, toxic bacteria, and it's strained. So everything you could possibly do wrong, you do wrong when you eat any animal protein. And so we don't need all the protein we're consuming. We're overeating protein by a massive amount. You can get all the protein you need from a healthy vegetarian diet or healthy plant-based diet. And look at some of the world's greatest athletes in history, like Carl Lewis. He won, I think, 12 to 15 gold medals, vegan. Edward Moses, great hurdler, vegan. So we've had Walton, the basketball player, vegan. I'm not sure if Abdul-Karim Jabbar was a vegan or vegetarian. I was told he was, but I never spoke with him. But in all sports, we have vegans who are top of the list. Mr. Universe, Mr. America, Mr. World, all have been vegans. So look at the strongest, longest-lived creatures in the world. The longest-lived creature that we know of, well, there's actually two. One is a shark. And lives in the northern waters around Greenland, and it can live 300 years or more. But the Galapagos turtle is a vegan, and they can easily live over 200 years. So everything about protein is a myth. It's been indoctrinated into us, and it shouldn't be. Our guest is standing by, but I do want to take one more. Let's go to one more quick call. I'll give a quicker answer on this one.
Well, it occurs to me that when I go shopping, I see a lot of insignias for USDA organic, and nowadays verified non-GMO. I was wondering how true these stamps are, and if perhaps there's hush money or bribery done to the inspector, given to the inspectors, so that the owners of these food sources can get a quick stamp for either organic or non-GMO. If this is true, I think it would be very interesting if you could do a show on it. If not, maybe just a simple yes or no would do for now. Thank you. Thank you for your service.
There are very high standards to meet to be certified organic. They used to be even higher. They've been watered down somewhat. But because of very vital organic movement, the standards are still in place. So if you see a stamp that says certified organic, then you can have confidence that no one's gotten a bribe. And also at farmers markets, they won't be certified organic because it's thousands of dollars to get certified. And these are just small little farmers. But you ask them questions. Do you use sprays? If so, what type? Because they're toxic sprays and non-toxic sprays. You can use, you know, apple cider vinegar with garlic and cayenne pepper, and that's a great spray for all your vegetables to keep insects off. So if a person tells you that they're not going to use sprays, A, sprays are toxic, and B, they're expensive, and they have their own way, and then get a conversation going so at least you can see what they're doing. And some will say organic, but it's not certified organic because, again, they can't afford to pay for that. And I'm willing to trust most people because I believe most people, when they're doing something, are doing it from integrity. So I don't believe that the industry is rife with corruption of people getting kickbacks to falsify some claim. Okay, so have confidence when you're eating certified organic or organic. Backing them up with my guest, please stay with us. We're going now to my guest, who's on Skype, standing by, and I gave you his introduction earlier, Abjamu Baraka, and we're going to talk about the strengths and weaknesses of the Green New Deal and how the Democrats have become the new war party, which is surprising because most people assume and have taken it that the Democratic Party that began to evolve away from the old racist party, the founders of the Ku Klux Klan, into a more progressive party, have continued to become more progressive. And many of us who used to be, you know, real believers in the Democratic Party and supported it, mainly because we were motivated by Franklin Delano Roosevelt and what he did. And he was a very wealthy man, but he also gave us some of the best programs, social programs in American history. And so let's go over and speak with my guest now. And he is, he's received a lot of awards. He won notable awards for his human rights efforts, including Abolitionist of the Year from the National Coalition of to Abolish the Death Penalty. And he is currently an editor and columnist for the Black Agenda Report, which appears on with Nellie Bailey and all the other, Bruce Dixon, here on the Progressive River Network on every Monday preceding my show. And he is also an associate at the Institute of Policy Studies in Washington, D.C. Nice to have you with us today.
It is a pleasure to be with you. Thank you.
Most people do not realize that the Green New Deal that the younger Democrats are pushing for as earlier precedents, a Yale University survey found that 81% of Americans, including 64% of Republicans, support the idea. Obama signed a prototype of a green bill in 2009 that was tied into his $800 billion American Recovery and Reinvestment Act stimulus to save the economy from depression. His law was supposed to move towards renewable clean energies. It hasn't done much. Last year, the U.S. only got 17% of its electricity from renewable sources, and over 7% of that was from hydropower, which has its own environmental shortcomings because we are speaking of dams. However, it was the Green Party back in 2006 that first formulated what was called then the Green New Deal Task Force proposal. In fact, it has been central to Jill Stein's and your platform during the 2016 presidential campaign. Yet nobody in the media, at least no one I'm aware of, nor the Democratic Party is giving acknowledgement to the Green Party for being way ahead of the curve on environmental issues to address climate change. In fact, more credit is given to the New York Times hack, Thomas Friedman, than to the Greens for its origination. That is just shocking, based upon a column he wrote a year after the Greens developed it. So I'd like you to speak about the Green Party's Green New Deal proposal, how much of it was hijacked by the new wave of left and of center Democrats, and what are its strengths and deficiencies. The forum is yours.
Well, thank you so much, and I really appreciate your question, and in particular, sharing with your audience some of the history of the evolution of this ideal and the Green Party platform. You're absolutely right. It is, you know, how this ideal has been responded to by the mainstream media has really been incredible. We remember during the campaign that when Jill had a sit down with the editorial board of the Washington Post, they came out with their report of that conversation, and they criticized Jill and criticized our platform as being unrealistic and not having a chance of any kind of advancement toward real legislation. They basically just completely rejected it. But now with the articulation of the Green New Deal ideal from some of these young Democrats, the Washington Post, New York Times, and most of the other mainstream media outlets have characterized it as absolutely brilliant. So it's really incredible. And I think it's hard to really completely understand the difference in the responses, perhaps maybe because some of us see that what Ocasio-Cortez is pushing is very different from what we were advocating. The first thing is that basically what she is pushing and the other young Democrats is a Green New Deal ideal. Part of the plan is for them to, in fact, have the Congress to come up with a committee that will then develop a plan. She has, in her articulations, used some buzzwords that suggest that the plan that they will come up with would not deviate very significantly from the sort of neoliberal logic that we see in place today. When you talk about having a plan where there's labor flexibility and encouraging entrepreneurship, it suggests that it will be a plan very different from the Green Party. The Green Party said basically that we had to move to an economy that was based on 100% renewable energy. And we had to do that fairly quickly. And I think that the science has supported that. But we recognize that to do that, it was going to take a political struggle. It was going to take a political struggle because we had to structurally transform how the economy operated. We had to move away from an economy that was dependent on these obsessive and obscene expenditures toward the military being one of the greatest emitters of carbon. We had to put some real constraints on the energy companies that had no objective interest in moving to an economy that's dependent on renewable energy. We had to recognize that, you know, we had to finance this through unconventional means, that we couldn't depend on the Federal Reserve, as the Ocasio version articulates, that the Federal Reserve, controlled by private banks, would be the main funder of this transformation, along with the private sector. We recognized that we had to have a different approach, which means public funding. We had to address the issue of the Federal Reserve by nationalizing the Federal Reserve. We had to have public banks that would help with this transition. And we had to have a just transition, understanding that the thousands of jobs that are now dependent on these dirty industries are represented by real live human beings. And then in a shift to a renewable energy economy, we had to have processes in place in which people would be able to retain their jobs and make a smooth transition. So there are a number of things that, you know, are very different from what is being articulated by Ocasio-Cortez and the Democrats and what we were trying to push and still trying to push today within the Green Party.
I appreciate that overview. Thank you. What is your assessment of this new wave of Democrats, such as Cortez and others, and do you feel that they will have much of an impact getting their agenda recognized by the old rank and file corporate Democrats and the media supporters the old rank and file has? The rank and file controls, as you know, most of the liberal media in the United States, and that now rule over the House. So the opinion leaders they control, the opinion policymakers they control. So what impact will they have?
Well, one of the things that we think is important is that they have at least been able to introduce the language and the concept or the need for us to really begin to seriously address the issue, the ecological crisis that we are facing as a collective humanity. We think it's important that there are more people in Congress now who are willing to at least consider more aggressive measures toward addressing these issues and moving in a direction in which more radical, if you will, measures might be embraced. So in terms of shifting the discourse, it's been very, very important. The problem will be, of course, in the details. And because of that, we see that there's been pushback from the from the leadership of the Democratic Party against these young people, because they understand that the implications of a real move toward addressing these issues and calling for a restructuring of the economy threatens economic interests that the Democratic Party is now still dependent on. So we believe there's going to be some shift in the discourse, which has already happened. But we believe that the whole idea will probably get bottled up in Congress, in committees, and not really go further than what it is today, unless there's a reaction from the public, a more aggressive set of demands coming from the public to really push these ideals forward.
I would like to see something that we have never seen, at least not in my lifetime. I would like to see the young, more idealistic Democrats and conservatives who are young and idealistic. I'm sure that they will find one. And I would like to see them embrace the philosophies that have woodwork, but are from more experience, the wise men and women of the past. I don't like the idea of these generational disconnects. I believe that if they were to invite you, because they have idealism, they have energy, and now they have position, but they do not have this scholarship, they do not have the in-depth knowledge. Every time I hear these people talk, they're talking without knowing what they're talking about. They have one large talking point and they stick to it, but get into the details and they're lost. Where you and others, Glenn Ford, the people who have very deep knowledge of social issues and social change and understanding politics, if you were side by side with them, if they brought you into committee hearings, brought you before the press when they're talking, I think that you would be able to make the more persuasive argument, and then they could use your argument to learn from, and they could then take it into the committees to start formulate programs that might make a difference. And also, I would like to see you and Jill and the others do short little informational pieces about the environment, hundreds of them, and throw them out there on YouTube so that we educate the public about how them becoming involved or not becoming aware or involved in the environment will directly impact them, either positively or negatively. And when people see something that impacts them, they'll make a difference. If they saw where meat came from and then saw the slaughter process so they could get something on their table without realizing where it came from, I believe that we could change some minds and help the environment by going towards a lower carbon footprint, methane footprint, with veganism and plant-based diets. That's my own personal prejudice. But I see there should not be just these people who do not have any depth on these issues at all, but do have personalities, charisma, and they have the power of the media to get attention. So why not bring in the wise men and women to help back up their messages? Your thoughts?
You know, Gary, those are very important and good ideals. I think that the challenge will be that the powers that be, that still will control the committees in Congress, are not really serious about really addressing the plan being pushed by these young Democrats. They prefer to use the slogans to sheepdog, if you will, young progressives and others into the Democrat Party without any real commitment to seriously addressing and developing something that could, in fact, move us forward in a progressive direction. So they would never really seriously bring people like myself and others who are even more grounded in this than I am to Congress to provide hearings, because I don't really believe they are prepared to take this seriously. This, Gary, is going to need a push from the bottom up, from the people themselves. It has to take, people have to embrace this and really begin to push this and push their representatives to embrace these ideals. Not only in terms of the Green New Deal, as people understand it, but that other element that you talked about when you introduced me, and that is the connecting issue of militarism. These issues have to be seriously and aggressively pushed by the public to make these representatives understand
that we can no longer afford politics as usual, and that if we're going to have a Green New Deal, if we're going to have the ability to address the ecological crisis that we are facing, we're going to have a planet that's savable, then basically we've got to not only address the issue of ecology, but also address the issue of the never-ending wars that we seem to be caught up in. So, you know, this is going to take a popular movement. And the good thing, again, about this movement is that at least people are talking about this now in a more serious way. There's been some degree of exposure. Again, though, I don't know how long it's going to last, but I can tell you this. Those of us who are in the Green Party, we are committed to pushing the dialogue forward for as long as we can until we are once again marginalized.
Well, we're going to be there to give voice to your support. I supported Jill Stein and Rocky Anderson and Ralph Nader. And I do not hold up much hope for this, the way this New Deal is being promoted as far as how it's being going to be received, because the military defense contractors and the military industrial complex is extremely powerful. They control Nancy Pelosi. They control Chuck Schumer. They have deep military adventurism and continuing the war hawk stance of Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama. And so you need new voices. And also, let us just remind this audience, the American media would like you to believe that the Green Party is insignificant. It's a tiny little local party. It is not. It is a worldwide party. In fact, the European countries hold the Green Parties and the Greens' philosophy very high. Germany, they have actually gained parliamentary seats. And we look at all of the climate change threats we are facing. This is a global crisis, and in effect, the Green Party is the only real political entity that reaches beyond the U.S. borders. And I commend you for what you're doing, and we will always provide you with a forum here on the Progressive Radio Network to spread that message. So I want to thank you for being out there.
I appreciate that, Gary.
You will hear more from my guest and more from the Greens, the people that actually originated this, and we will see a lot of articles. We've published 7 major environmental articles. They're up on PRN.fm. And if you would like to reach out to our guest today or the Green Party, let me spell his email address. It's ajamubaraka.com. So we thank you, Ajamu Baraka, for being on, and all the best to the Green Party and all of its members. I'm Gary Nong. We're out of time. Thank you all for listening. And tonight, 7 o'clock, Danny Sheehan, and it is going to be an in-depth look at the coup that is occurring right now in the United States. And the media is complicit, and we're going to dissect it piece by piece. Have a nice day, everyone.